Next is Roberta Fagan.
Here I am again.
Welcome.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair and members of the committee. My name is Roberta Fagan. I'm with the Oil Heat Institute of Rhode Island, and I'm also a member of the Rhode Island Business Coalition. I did sign on to a letter that the coalition did submit, but I just wanted to...
You all have that here about that?
Yes. But again, Oil Heat Institute is a nonprofit organization advocating for delivered fuel customers and the related businesses providing our products and services to keep our customers comfortable. I'm here today in opposition of Senate Bill 2747, the Rhode Island Global Warming Solutions Act. In the written testimony provided by the Rhode Island Business Coalition, we outlined many of our concerns on the efficacy of this bill and its aggressive goals to displace heating oil and propane equipment with electric heat. And I do note electric heat means different things today rather than the baseboards. I just would like to just talk to that about that for just one quick moment, not part of my verbal testimony, but air source heat pumps, in general, their application is not the same in every home, every building. And the installation is very, very important to the resulting efficiency. We have a lot of rules and regs in Rhode Island as far as our mechanical trades that make it almost impossible for anybody to get into the mechanical trades. That is a totally separate issue from today, and I won't go into the details, but in Massachusetts, for somebody to install a heat pump, it's easy. In Rhode Island, it's not. The rules and regs required for the mechanical trades to install a piece of equipment efficiently, correctly, when you think about the envelope of the house, is far more complicated than just buying one at Home Depot and installing it yourself. So there's a lot of technology out there, and I would love to talk more about that in the future. But moving back to my testimony in regards to the Global Warming Solutions Act, Rhode Island, approximately 35 to 40% of Rhode Island residential homes utilize delivered fuels for water and space heating. Rhode Island, and I'm sure you are aware of this, Rhode Island has a 5% biodiesel mandate in every gallon of heating oil. And on July 1st of 2018, Rhode Island, along with the rest of the New England states, will be transitioning from low sulfur heating oil, which is 15 parts per million sulfur, to ultra low sulfur heating oil. That's 15 parts per million, and that's what vehicles on the road use. So it's the lowest sulfur emitting product that is available. But more importantly, combined with biodiesel, this will result in the cleanest burning and efficient product that we have to offer at this time. This also means that our homeowners are going to be reducing their usage by doing practically nothing. No costly conversions, they don't have to do anything to their existing heating equipment. Our industry hasn't sat back and done nothing. We are doing our best to spend and invest time and money on research and development to continue improving our products and services to help our customers conserve more, which when it comes right down to it, we need to conserve rather than get rid of or penalize people who are using carbon-intense fuels. One other thing, Rhode Island now approximately has about 1% of electric heat for usage. I am very concerned about when we go from 1 to 100% for electric use, even though we're talking about more efficient energy out there, what that demand is going to do to the grid. ISO New England doesn't rely on one fuel to make sure that the lights stay on, the air conditioning keeps going, and our heat is still there. We use varying sources of energy. Natural gas is the primary right now, but in times of peak demand, like we had in January, heating oil was the primary product that was used, and that heating oil had biodiesel. So that's my little plug for biodiesel. But in addition to heating oil, coal is used, nuclear is used, hydro is used, as well as other renewables. So I won't bore you with any more details. I just want to say that we are moving things forward. We are really trying to help our energy users use less fuel. And just based on the way Rhode Island, certain parts of rural Rhode Island, and places like Jamestown, I'm a resident of Jamestown, we rely on delivered fuels or, you know, a heat pump. Those really, heat pumps are costly. And as a consumer myself, if somebody told me I had to go out and spend somewhere between $5,000 and $10,000 on a new heat source that may or may not work as efficiently as the package says because somebody that wasn't qualified installed it, I would feel like there was somebody misinformed me. So moving forward, I just would implore you to really do research about what we're doing in our industry as far as Bybee is concerned and how we are part of the solution here in Rhode Island as of today. So thank you for your time, and I would welcome any questions.
Yes, I have a question. We were talking about the process for installation of heat pumps in Rhode Island as compared to Massachusetts, and I believe you said that it was far more complicated to install them.
Yes.
In Rhode Island, are you talking about the building codes in Rhode Island?
You mean a refrigeration license, heat pack refrigeration license, and in order to get that license, you have to do the theoretical study, which could take anywhere from 2 to 5 years, depending on how aggressive you pursue that theoretical. You also have to be sponsored by a licensed master or journey person, and we have an aging workforce of masters and journey persons. To become an apprentice in the mechanical trades is really difficult because of the ratios as well. It's a one-to-one ratio, which means one apprentice to one master or journey person in residential applications. But keep in mind that that master or journey person can have one apprentice working under them for the amount of time that it takes that apprentice to get through the program. So when you talk about getting your pipe fitter license, which you need, in addition to your refrigeration license, which you need to install a heat pump, it could take you 8 to 10 years to get that proper licensing to install it on your own. Major, major hurdles. And I'm working on that as well. And workforce development, let's do it.
So I'm trying to understand that Massachusetts is much easier, so they don't have those type of requirements for the installers of heat pumps.
Licensing is a little bit different, whereas depending on the size of the equipment, and again, the HVAC and the refrigeration side, I do grapple with, but essentially it's the type of, it has to do with the Freon and,
right,
and how much Freon, and so that also, it depends on the size of the equipment. It's a little bit less requirement to get the license to install a residential unit in Massachusetts, whereas in Rhode Island, you have to get
thank you. Senator Paul?
Yes. Are those the same requirements to put in the air conditioning system?
Yes. So refrigeration.
So if you can install an air conditioner, you can install a heat pump?
As long as you have the license to do so.
Okay. So my understanding is there's a lot of people that can install the air conditioner, so is that...
I think that we probably would like to look at the numbers from the Department of Labor and Training and find out how many of those people are properly licensed.
Okay.
I think there are a lot of people out there that are not properly licensed doing the work. And yes, I think that's, and I, you know, we want to get more people, more qualified people, but we've got rules and regs that would need to be changed before we can get more people doing things competently and legally.
Thank you.
One other question, if I may. You must talk to your colleagues in Massachusetts. How has this affected, I guess I'm just curious, We hear from proponents of the bill, how Massachusetts is going forward. How has it affected the, and maybe it's not a fair question, but maybe something you can get back to me on, but how has it affected the folks in Massachusetts in your industry in oil heat?
Well, I think that it's affected Rhode Island more because we're smaller. And Massachusetts, they're second or third largest heating oil state in the nation. They have, you know, they have a biodiesel legislation on the books, but they do not have a mandate. Everybody's blending, but it's Rhode Island only is the only state that actually has the mandate. New York has a separate biodiesel incentive programs, but as far as conversions to you know, a different heat source, we're all feeling the effects of it, but when it comes right down to it, it's looking at the best use for that type of equipment, maybe in the shoulder seasons, but 365 days of the year is not necessarily the proper use for a heat pump in the New England states. So again, I think it's individual too. I mean, you may have a, I don't know, 1200 square foot home, or you know, I might have a 500 square foot home, or somebody else at this table might have a 3500 square foot home. The application of those heat pumps is different in each of the homes, and the cost to install in each of those homes is different. And when it comes, I mean, think about our low-income folks. If it's mandated, and a lot of our low-income folks live in, you know, multi-unit or rental properties, how is that going to trickle down to them? So, I mean, there are so many moving parts, and it's very. I was on the EC4 coordinating council, not on the coordinating council, but I was part of the whole study. And there's still some questions about how we're going to get to the 2050 goals. There are a lot of assumptions about technology filling in the back end, and from an economic standpoint, there's a lot of weight being put in that the equipment cost will reduce over time. I just, as a Rhode Island consumer, that's a lot for me to accept here and now.
So I'm still a current member on the EC4, or you were?
Well, the EC4 was formed in order to do the study that is the basis of the Rhode Island Global Warming Solutions.
Any further questions?